Hi, in for this module you will learn why standardizing your XML is such a good idea. And we will do that by introducing to you to the Text Encoding Initiative, OTEI. So why standardizing? Well, we can do that by showing you this example. You see in this image, there is some wording and there is something that is written in the interlinear space. And what is this exactly? Well, it depends how you look at it. It could say, okay, this is an addition, or someone else would say, actually, no, I call it an insertion. I would call it that an inclusion, or someone else can say, well, that is simply a correction. Another one would say, well, maybe it's a modification. So all of that are correct answers to what is the thing we are looking at. But if we do not agree on the same name, we may have some problem afterwards to share our files, to share our work, and to understand each other when we talk about something. In fact, you will see that a correction, a modification, an addition are not the same thing. Not only that, you would say, okay, once we have agreed on what it is, how do you mark it up? Which is the name of the element that I will use to mark this up? We can call it add and say, well, it is in the interlinear space. Or we can call it ins, which is above, etc., etc. So you see some example of possible encoding of the same thing here. So what is the Text Encoding Initiative? It is a markup scheme. It's an ensemble of lots of XML elements that have been created to facilitate the interchange of research between scholars around the world. It's born in 86, before even the web was invented, so it has been longer, for more than 30 years now. And it provides some guidelines for people to learn how to use it. And you know what? It has more than 500 elements. So it's enough to satisfy the needs of most researchers around the world. So what is the TI for? It is good for interchange of data. It is independent from platforms. It is open to new tools because it's written in XML. Therefore, if someone invents a new tool that uses XML, well, you can use your TI with that. It's good for preservation because of that, because it's not connected to a single software. And it's based on a large scholarly community. There is a website where you can find more information about it. How does it look like? Well, let's look at first a TI file. You see on the screen that we have what we call the root element, and it's called TI. Well, that's not a big surprise, is it? Inside your TI root element, you have two main elements. One is called TI header. The other one is called text. In the TI header, you will put your metadata. In the text, you put your text. Let's see an example of the metadata. Let's start with that. On the left-hand side, you see an image of a manuscript. This is the first page of the Gettysburg Address by Abraham Lincoln, the Hay copy that is preserved at the Library of Congress. So in my metadata, within an element called file desk, description of my file, I have a few elements in which I describe the things I just told you. So what it is, who's the author, and where it comes from. So you see there is, within file desk, we have an element called title statement, within which we have an element called title. And there I put the Gettysburg Address, the Hay copy. This is actually not the name of the document, but the name of your encoding, the digital version. The author is Abraham Lincoln, and that's where he's going, within an element called author. After that, you see there is a publication statement, and that is, what can you do with this file? Metadata is not just for describing what you do and where this material comes from, but what is the possibility that what can you do with that? So if I'm a third person and I found your file, what can I do with that? This example, I said, well, this encoding is only for exercise, for a transcription exercise. So basically, you cannot do anything with that. But if you are to publish your digital edition on the internet, you will put some kind of licensing, a Creative Commons licensing, for example, exactly in this place, where you allow people to do what you think it is correct. Finally, there is an element called source desk. And in the source desk, you say, where does it come from? And here I say it comes from the Library of Congress. So there you have it. This is the metadata. The TI header is very complex. Hundreds of elements can be put in there. And some of them will be seeing them bit by bit as the course goes on. But for the moment, I think it's enough. Those are what we call the obligatory elements, because the TI thinks that a file without metadata is not a scholarly file. Now that we have seen how that it works on the metadata, let's look how it works on the data, on the text. Here you see that I have transcribed the first paragraph of the Gettysburg Address, and I've done so within the text. Within the text, I've opened an element called body. The body is the main corpus, main body of your text. If you need it, it can be preceded by another element called the front and followed by another element called the back. That replicates more or less the structure of books with, you know, dedication, introduction in front of the in the front and appendices on your back. Here we just have the body, and that's what we have there. I've used an element called div inside the body that as an attribute type speech. A div is a division. It's something that you use to break down your text in subsections. In this case, we don't have many breakdown because it's the all text within the main div. But think of a novel, think of a collection of poems. Each of them have a structure or a play with scenes and acts in there. Within your div, I used a P element. Within the P element, I have used a line break element, LB. We shall see more about that in another module. But just to tell you what it is, the P stands for a paragraph. And line break marks the beginning of a line on my manuscript. Because when I do transcription, I like to keep my lines the way they were on the text. The TI offers you lots of elements to mark up many of the normal features you find in a text. Here you see a couple of examples of basic commodities of text, lists and table. For the list type of things, I put an element list with a type attribute bulleted. And for each of the entry of my list, I use an element item. This way, I replicate on the right what I may find on my text, which you can see on your left. The second one is a table. Tables are particular because they are defined by their layout. You can read them horizontally or vertically, in columns or in row. XML cannot have both this. It cannot have columns and row because it's linear. So what happens is that it has been chosen to privilege row level with respect to the columns in your table. So the columns are only made such by the fact that you will use different cells within your row, one on top of the other. So you see on the right-hand side, I have an element called table, and within which I have two elements, row, okay? Because the cell element actually is there, but it's not within table, it's within row. So we learn how to see elements inside one another. So cell is a direct child only of row, not of table. The first set of cell have an attribute, which is role, meaning that the content of these cells are the label, the things that in my left-hand side are in gray to show the name of my columns. To encode poems, as well, TI offers a specialized set of elements. The very simple one is given by stanzas and verses. The TI use line as a name, and therefore stanza are called LG, line groups. And verses are called L, lines, lines of a poem. You see in the example that I've used an element div, division, for this one. So div actually can be used for all type of text. The title of this division has been encoded within an element called head, the heading of this division, that is the title. Notice that the TI used the element title for citations of bibliographical references and head for the title of a section that is actually transcribed. After that, you have an LG because the poem Les Dormeurs du Val of Rimbaud has two stanzas. So two LG elements are being provided. Each of them have four L elements inside that contains a single verse. Notice that L is a line of poem and cannot be used for line of manuscripts, for which we use the LB element. If you want more information about these elements or any of the elements, indeed, we will talk in about our modules, you can go to the website of the TI to see the guidelines. The guidelines are a formidable publication, but they're also very, very useful. There is a lot of information, lots of examples in there. And this is the homepage of the guidelines. There is also a very easy to use appendix called elements, which you have the list of all the elements that you that is in the TI. You can click on one of them and see whatever they say about it. Well, it's a small description. There is normally the list of the attributes, and there is also some example of usage.